those kind of absolute moments of emotional connection with the material, and you're in the throes of whatever torment and passion, that it's kind of a peaceful place, in that you're not generating anything, you're not having to do any work, you're not exhausting yourself, it's just happening, and it's sort of nothing to do with you, and you become kind of anonymous. But you only get there through, through finding whatever's right in the middle and plugging it in. But again, that doesn't have to be the horrible, painful stuff. It's just as exposing to really, really laugh. And I feel like I've not quite struck the right tone, because my memory is also full in this room of laughing until I thought I was going to die. Being in just tears, just rolling down my face of laughter and rupturing a stomach muscle because of it. So many funny memories in here. But that means that it's the feelings business. You're dealing with great, great intimacy. And this is one place where you can find times. I mean, you don't get paid to do it when it's easy. You get paid to do it when it's the last thing in the world you want to do. And still be able to turn up and do it. Like I say, when it's easy, you shouldn't be getting paid to do it. It's weightless, and it costs you nothing. The one thing I learned about that, funny, it was on Henry V actually, that there was a performance happening where it just wasn't happening. We were into the second half by this point. The audience was just clearly not coming with us. There was a lot of acting happening on the stage, and the audience it just wasn't coming together. And I was this was quite late on in the run. I'd actually ruptured the intercostal muscle here, which meant that every breath I took, no matter how shallow, was intensely painful, let alone having to take big gulping breaths for long strains of verse. I was on steroids for my voice because my throat was this size, and it was all a mess. And this performance was just not happening. And I was doing the night before Agincourt speech, when it's Lenny's low point, and I just ran out of steam and talent, and I just stopped because I was exhausted of trying to be in the moment and not being in the moment. You know what I mean? I had no acting left. I just stopped. And I took a breath. And I found a groundling. And I just tried to take all my acting off and just put it on the ground. And just say the next line. It didn't make very much sense. But something happened in that everyone's ears kind of pricked up in that moment. Because something was actually happening in the room. Something honest, something real, that wasn't rehearsed and done 100 times. And that's the thing, is you've got to keep it the show that you've rehearsed. It's still the same, everybody goes in the same place, you've got to find your light. But you also have to work with what's actually going on right now. So that's your point of entry. So if you're stressed and hacked off about stuff that's happening, then start with that. Start with whatever's actually happening, even if it's, I'm an actor who's in trouble right now, because we all... There's a brilliant story of Ralph Richardson, who was in the middle of a play, and he stopped in the middle of it, and he said, "Is there a doctor in the house?" And someone went, "Yes." And he went, "Doctor, isn't this a terrible play?" I love that, because that should always be on the table as a possibility. If the audience feel like something like that could happen, then you're in a place of frankness. You'd think more people would do that, but they don't. And so the producer is Sonny Friedman, who we were on each other's radar, we didn't know each other. The director and choreographer seen stuff I'd been in, I knew their stuff, and I'd worked with a few other people on the creative team. I was doing another show, I was in Birmingham, on Guys and Dolls before we came into London. So they said, I got this call and said, In principle, would you be interested for a year in Harry Potter and the West End? I was like, is it a musical? Which part? He's like 17, isn't he? You know, I wasn't on the right page at all. And then I saw who was doing it, and I immediately, like, the writer's brilliant, you know. And I said, yeah, of course, I'd love to. They said, well, we can't send you the script, you have to come to Sonia's office and read it. So I had to come to London, go to her office, sign a non-disclosure agreement, sit in a room for five hours, and read 250 pages of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child, early draft, go back to Birmingham, and then have one more trip to meet Stephen and John, read the scenes and do a bit of movement, so I didn't have two left feet, and that was it. And we were halfway through the dress rehearsal in London for Guys and Dolls, and I got a call saying that it had come through, and sort of did the second half of Guys and Dolls with a slightly weird expression on my face. Harry Potter? it was not kind of, you know, if you'd asked me 6 weeks before to pick that possibility out of the, I would just never have chosen it, I'd like never have picked it. It was kind of bolt from the blue. But, you know, so it happens sometimes. Sometimes it's incredibly long and drawn out. I did about 8 rounds for a musical once and then didn't get the part.